Now, if you're of a certain age, the words Top of the Pops will mean Thursday nights in front of the telly with a load of shushing from you, telling your parents to stop asking if Boy George was a man or a woman, or you, as that parent, asking your kids if Boy George was a man or a woman. Happy days when the TV brought the family together. Now, a new book celebrates the show and documents 619 episodes between 1964 and 75, where many of the show's tapes were wiped to save money. Can you imagine such scandal? Peter Checksfield from Kent is the man behind it, and he joins us now on Vintage Vinyl. Peter, welcome.
Thank you, Mark.
Lovely to have you with us. Do you remember your first experience of watching Top of the Pops? Is that something that's etched in your mind, that first Top of the Pops moment?
Well, I was born 1963, the year before it started. So but I remember pretty much everything from about 71 onwards. Probably the glam rock, T-Rex, Sweet, Slade, they're the first to have an impact. So when I was about 8, 9, 10 years old.
Oh, yeah, the real heyday, wasn't it? Eh?
Yeah.
Glam rock era. I never realised...
And Pans People.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, you kind of forget about the Pans People and the Legs and Co's and all that side of Top of the Pops. I never realised how many of those early shows were missing. How many exactly do you think have gone?
Oh, hundreds. 500, 550 are missing.
And let's have some music. I mean, I've asked you to pick out some acts that mean something to you from the Top of the Pops days. And the first that you've gone for is The Move and Night of Fear. Why that one?
It's just a very funny story in the book. I'll read it to you if you like.
Please
from
do.
Bev,
yeah.
Bevan. Bev Bevan, who was a drummer in The Move and later ELO. And he put, "We were nervous but very excited to be on the nation's biggest music TV show. It would have been January 1967. Our debut single, Night of Fear, had entered the charts. The Monkees were number one with I'm a Believer, but they weren't on Live. Cat Stevens was on the show promoting Matthew and Son. I remember Carl Wayne and myself and Cat Stevens all watching the tremolos at rehearsal, playing their current hit, Here Comes My Baby. Carl said, 'I hate this bleep song.' I said, 'Yes, it is pretty. Bleep. Isn't it?' To which Cat Stevens replied, 'Thanks a lot, guys. I wrote this.'"
Oh, that's terrific.
Bev said, "Embarrassing or what? But he was a nice bloke and saw the funny side."
Oh, brilliant stuff. We'll come to the memories of the stars in more detail in just a moment. But let's hear this first. The Move, Night of Fear on Vintage Vinyl.
Silent night has turned to a night of fear.
Yeah, The Move, Night of Fear. Mark from their appearance on Top of the Pops with that song. And marking this book, Top of the Pops, The Lost Years Rediscovered, 1964-75, written by Peter Checksfield, who's with us on Vintage Vinyl this week. I mean, 650 pages long this book is, Peter. I'm guessing a real labour of love. How did you go about putting it together, and how long did it take?
Well, to actually write the book, not that long, probably about 9 months, but I've been collecting data for literally 30 years at least, and I've been collecting rare footage since I got my first VHS recorder on high purchase in 1981, so over 40 years actually collecting the rare footage, which I did screenshots for the book. So the actual writing, not particularly long, but the preamble, if you like, 40 years. So.
Yeah, it's just a lifelong experience. And the detail in this is superb. I mean, just to kind of let listeners know about the layout of the book, you've got the detail of each individual episode. So I'm looking at this one here from 1967, for example, episode 181, the 15th of June, presented by Alan Freeman. You've got Procol Harum kicking it off with A Whiter Shade of Pale. Well, that was number one, certainly. I don't know whether it kicked it off. But other acts in that particular edition, Judith Durham, with The Olive Tree, Cream, Strange Brew, that's a tune. Dave D, Dozy Beaky Mick and Titch. I mean, those were back in the days before the videos, which would represent some of the acts in later years. So were all the acts in those early days actually there live?
Yeah, pretty much so. They'd repeat appearances occasionally. And some of the bigger stars, like the Beatles, more often than not did pre-recorded inserts, which they'd play, because they're... I think they'd go out of the way for Beatles and not many other people.
I wonder what they did exactly before Pan's People and Legs and Co. kind of did their thing when the bands or the artists couldn't get to the studio.
Well, basically, they'd show the audience dancing.
Oh, right,
Literally, they'd play the record and show the audience dancing.
Oh, well, this is terrific. And that will nicely set up something I'm going to mention in just a moment. But as we've said before, nice memories from some of the stars who appeared. How easy or difficult was it to get some of those people to contribute to the book? And who have we got? Name some other names.
I've got over 50 people. I've got Frank Allen and Mike Pender of the Searchers, Peter Asher of Peter and Gordon, Eric Bell of the Early Guitars of Thin Lizzy, Jeff Christie of Christie, Keithy D, Ray Dorsett of Mungo Jerry, Anita Harris. Quite a few. Brian Paul, PJ Proby, briefly, Susie Quattro.
Superb.
It wasn't that difficult to get them to help me. The biggest problem was them remembering.
I suppose so. Yeah, not just because it was quite a long time ago, but possibly because of the hedonistic nature of a Top of the Pops appearance.
And for example, Mike Pender of the Searchers, I mean, he's 80 years old, so it was a long time ago, but he's got a pretty good memory. But he said he always confuses Top of the Pops with Thank Your Lucky Stars. So right. He said, I'll tell you an anecdote, but I'm not sure if it's Top of the Pops or Thank Your Lucky Stars. So it was that sometimes.
Yeah, the two are kind of interchangeable, I suppose. But yeah, I do know from sort of legend of working at the BBC, as I have done for well over 30 years now, you know, it was kind of the case, and probably wouldn't exist now, but you know, the BBC bar was somewhere that an act would frequent before and after a performance at Top of the Pops. So you can get the idea of the whole style and the vibe of the Top of the Pops recording.
Oh yeah, Junior Campbell of he was in Marmalade, but later a solo star, and he recalls meeting Bobby Moore, the footballer. In there, because Bobby Moore was on the show as part of the England World Cup team singing Back Home.
Oh, fabulous.
But he said in the bar, he said to Bobby Moore, I'd throw all this away to be a footballer. And Bobby Moore said, I'd throw all this away to be a pop star. Yeah.
There you go. The grass is always greener, isn't it, eh? Oh, that's lovely.
Exactly.
You mentioned about the photos. Were all of the photos that appear in the book, and some lovely pictures, were they all sort of screen grabs, or did some exist as actual photos?
Screen grabs. A couple of other people, Steve Ellis sent me a beautiful photograph of him rehearsing for a Top of the Pops, and Junior Campbell, as I've just mentioned.
Excellent.
He sent me a rehearsal script, which shows the layout, who did what. And he said he's very proud of it because on the bill, although he was only on video, of course, was Elvis Presley. And he said, I've been on the same bill as Elvis Presley.
That's a claim to fame. Wow, that's terrific. Because I wonder whether there was ever a show photographer going around actually snapping these acts who were huge, really. You know, you kind of think, you know.
There was in the 60s and early 70s, Harry Goodwin.
Oh, terrific, yeah. But yeah, this is laden beautifully with photographs from each programme, and just wonderful to thumb through. It's a real sort of coffee table book, this. Let's have another tune. You're going for Christie next. Why this one?
Oh, it's a great record. But again, a little anecdote is Jeff Christie. One Top of the Pops memory etched in my memory is when we, Christie, were on the same bill as The Who when they released their single, The Seeker. Last minute rehearsal of the live recording the late afternoon before the audience were permitted was when the studio techs would run through camera checks, etc. We were already out on the floor, out of camera shot, awaiting our turn, following The Mighty Who, of which Townsend, Daughtry and Entwistle were already fidgeting on stage, waiting for the moon, who was late for his call. He eventually emerged from the shadows, walking briskly past us with a dangerous smile, and said a friendly, "Hello, boys," when he stopped, turned back, and put a kiss firmly on the guitarist Vic Helm's cheek, then proceeded to jump on a stage and took his place behind the drum kit. A hilarious episode which undoubtedly helped quell any pre-show nerves for us, at least, if not others, and one of many great memories for those heady days. A little backstory, actually. The Tremolos recorded it first, and they decided they wanted to go in a more progressive direction, and then they got Jeff Christie in to record over the Tremolos backing their tape. Christie got to number one, and then the Tremolos' current record only got to number 33. And for years afterwards, the Tremolos saying we could kick ourselves. We wish we hadn't done that decision. We would have had the number one. So.
There you go, you see. Be careful before you turn your nose up at something, because it
well,
could be
exactly,
a massive hit. Let's hear this then, the classic Yellow River from Christie on 55. Christie and Yellow River on Vintage Vinyl with my guest this week, Peter Checksfield, who's written this fantastic book. And if you're at all interested in pop music and indeed Top of the Pops, then it is a must, because it goes through episode by episode the early years of Top of the Pops, and some of the programmes that, for shame, the BBC wiped in their, well, I say wisdom, back in the day, it was to kind of save money, because those tapes were pretty expensive, so they were kind of allegedly doing the licence fee payer a favour by reusing the tapes, but in doing so, we lost a lot of great shows, including, obviously, Dad's Army and some Doctor Who's and things like that, but a load of the early Top of the Popses as well. Did you ever go and see the show, Peter?
No, I did not. By the time I was old enough, I wasn't so interested in the show, so no, I didn't. But.
Yeah, I did a couple of times in my early days of working for the Beeb, and I do remember, it's a wonderful memory I have. I think they were on the same bill. Krista Burr, who did, I think, Missing You, and Whitney Houston. And I remember Whitney Houston, she did look over at me. She looked over at me and, you know, what might have been, I don't know, but there we are. And that leads me to invite anybody that is listening that went to see Top of the Pops and, you know, could have been standing next to Simon Bates or whatever. If you remember that you got a clear shot on Top of the Pops back in the day, you went there, let me know, because the episode may still exist in our archives and we may be able to dig it out and find it for you and actually send you a clip or put it on social media or something.
The vast majority of episodes from 1976 onwards survive. There's only about 19 missing from 76, 77. Then they all survive. But before that, it's very hit and miss.
So that's the sort of timeline we're looking at. Post sort of 75, 76, then you're in with a chance. But yeah, if you want to drop me a line, mark.punter@bbc.co.uk, it'd be lovely to dig that out and show you and have your reminiscences about your visit to Top of the Pops. Did you have a favourite lineup or a favourite show from all those years, Peter?
The high point for me was the 1973 Christmas special, and it still survives, and it really was the height of glam. I mean, Slater on it twice, Susie Quattro, Wizard, I can't remember all the others, but you know, pretty much anyone who was anyone at the time. And,
yeah.
And obviously you always had a couple of the acts that you wouldn't be so keen on, like Little Jimmy Osmond and Dawn,
yes.
Yellow Ribbon. But, yes. But that was part of the magic of Top of the Pops. Yeah, you know, it really was something for everyone. I think that was, yeah, that's why I loved it so much.
Absolutely.
And that's why the parents watched it as well.
So. Yeah, there was no shame, was there? They would quite happily sort of show, I'm trying to think of an act that was around at the time, but a hip act, let's say, and then follow it with Terry Wogan doing the floral dance.
Terry Wogan doing a floral dance, yeah, exactly. Or there's no one quite like Grandma.
Yeah,
or
yeah,
like
there was no shame whatsoever. But they made the charts and got airplay, so, you know, why not? I can't actually decide, Peter, whether it's a show that's ripe for revival, because it really did introduce you and the great British public to new acts and songs, and without which you might not have been aware of that stuff, because it would have meant sort of purposefully listening to a radio station, of which there were very few at the time in the 60s and 70s. But Top of the Pops was kind of, you know, what you did. You settled down, you watched Thursday night on the BBC, of course, were there any other channels, and you watched Top of the Pops and got introduced to loads of new chart acts and songs. What do you think? Do you think that there's a market or an appetite for it coming back?
I've got very mixed emotions over it, to be honest. I mean, it finally finished in 2006, and for at least 5 years before that. So very few people buy singles these days. You know, that is the trouble, with streaming. And I don't know. Yeah, I can see the pros and cons. I really can. So.
Yeah, I just think as a way of introducing people to music acts that are out there and doing stuff and finding it hard to kind of get a foothold, Top of the Pops really did a lot for those.
I do feel sorry for acts these days, because as well as Top of the Pops, you'd have so many programmes. I'd appear on, I don't know, the Basil Brush Show and things like that.
Yeah.
There was countless things, Crackerjack, you know, all these things where bands would have plugged their record and they're all gone. So must be very difficult for bands these days to find somewhere, you know, on mainstream TV to plug their record.
Yeah, I totally agree. We do a vinyl chart countdown on this programme, and that in itself provides me with an opportunity to see what is around and in the charts that I wouldn't have otherwise have heard of. And a lot of the stuff is great. You kind of play a little 30-second clip of something that's number 8 in the vinyl charts. You think, that's really good, but you won't hear it getting airplay elsewhere. And as I say, I think that's what Top of the Pops did, certainly for the lower reaches of the charts, when acts were kind of having a go and coming out and sort of trying to deliver their wares to the British public. And that was a way of getting a foothold on the charts. And it was a magnificent thing in that respect. Let's have a final Top of the Pops tune. You've gone for Paper Lace. What's the story behind this one?
Oh, yeah. It's a great record. I like Paper Lace a lot. No one seems to talk about them these days. But, a very nice anecdote. It's called The Night Chicago Died. And from Philip Wright, the drummer of Paper Lace, he said, I've always been a massive Elton John fan. When we got to number one in the USA with The Night Chicago Died, we were on Top of the Pops with Elton. We were standing around, as you do, watching the different acts. And out of the corner of my eye, I saw Elton John heading straight for me. As he approached, his hand was outstretched. He shook my hand and said, "Congratulations on your number one in America. Well done." I was gobsmacked and speechless. One of my personal memorable occasions.
That's fantastic, isn't it? And you've picked one of my favourite tunes as well. And again, it's something you don't often hear on the radio, The Night Chicago Died by Paper Lace. So we're going to finish with that. I will just remind listeners that this book is Top of the Pops, The Lost Years Rediscovered, 64 to 75, by Peter Checksfield. And there is one final little anecdote in the back here that I'd like to deliver, if I may, in the epilogue, from Graham Gouldman, who said, 10cc were appearing on Top of the Pops, and Earth, Wind and Fire were also on the bill. I told Kevin this, and he replied, "Yes, I know. I passed Wind on the way into the studio," which is fantastic. That's such a great line. I love it. Peter, a great pleasure to talk to you, my friend. Good luck with the book, and keeping the memories of Top of the Pops alive and here from that show, and the charts of the day. Paper Lace and The Night Chicago Died.
Thank
good
you,
to
Mark.
Talk to you.
Daddy was a cop on the east side of Chicago, back in the USA, back in the bad old days. In the heat of a summer night, in the land of the dollar bill, when the town of Chicago died, and they talk about it still. When a man named Al Capone tried to make that town his own, and he called his gang to war with the forces of the law, I heard my mama cry. I heard her pray the night Chicago died. Brother, what a night it really was. Brother, what a fight it really was. Glory be. I heard my mama cry. And the sound of the battle rang through the streets of the old east side, till the last of the hoodlum gang had surrendered up or died. They were shouting in the street and the sound of running feet, and I asked someone who said about 100 cops are dead. I heard my mama cry. I heard her pray the night she cried. Brother, what a night it really was. Brother, what a thought it really was. Glory be. I heard my mama cry. I heard her pray the night Chicago died. Brother, what a night the people saw. Brother, what a thought the people saw. Yes, indeed. Then there was no sound at all, clock upon the wall. Then the door burst open wide, and my daddy stepped inside, and he kissed my mama's face, and he brushed her tears away. The night Chicago died. Chicago died. The night Chicago died. Brother, what a night it really was. Brother, what a fight it really was. Glory.
should call a doctor.